Hi everybody, welcome to the last of the undergraduate lecture series that I was giving. Tonight it's mainly on aspects of treatment, and I'm going to start with topical corticosteroids, then do systemic drug therapy, then I'm going to flick back into this first one here on treating skin disease, depending on how much time we in fact have. So let's start on topical corticosteroids. Okay, I've said that choosing a topical corticosteroid is a bit of an art. Why did I say that? Well, you've got to have an idea of the relative strengths of the steroid cream that you're going to put on, and you've got to also know the disease itself. You know, some diseases can get away with a relatively weak topical corticosteroid to deal with them, and others need a strong topical corticosteroid. For instance, many cases of atopic dermatitis, it's just in the epidermis. You know, the spongiosis is between the keratinocytes and the epidermis, and a relatively weak topical steroid is able to penetrate adequately into the epidermis and help to suppress the process. So often a dermatitis can be dealt with 1% hydrocortisone, or perhaps with a little bit of 0.02% betamethasone. But say you've got another disease like lupus or lichen planus, and in that disease, the disease, or bullous pemphigoid, you know, the blistering disease. In those diseases, the disease is at the dermoepidermal junction. In other words, it's deep in, it's at the junction of the epidermis with the dermis. So your steroid has to be able to penetrate deep in there to be able to suppress that inflammatory process. And some of the weaker topical corticosteroids just won't penetrate enough. So it's a question of knowing the it's a question of knowing the disease, the nature of the disease, where it is, and also I've said there the site of the condition. For instance, remember I said the stratum corneum that has the little layer of dead cells on the surface of the skin that gives you the normal barrier function. That varies tremendously the thickness of it over the body. Eyelid skin is awfully thin. So you've only got a very, very thin stratum corneum there, whereas the stratum corneum in the palms of the hands and the soles of the feet is very, very thick. So if you've got a disease that's affecting the palms of the hands and the soles of the feet, you're going to need a strong steroid to get through that thick stratum corneum in the first place to be able to penetrate in there. So there's little point using a wee bit 1% hydrocortisone on a skin disease of the palms of the hands and the soles of the feet. It just won't penetrate adequately. Whereas with the eyelids, the only thing you'd ever want to use up there from a point of view of a topical steroid is 1% hydrocortisone. The other reason you don't want to use strong steroids around the eyelids is the risk of glaucoma. Because, you know, there's a lot of little veins there that drain into the back of the eye. And if you use a strong fluorinated steroid up around there, it can lead to an increase in intraocular pressure and the induction of glaucoma, especially if the patient already has glaucoma or a tendency to it. A strong fluorinated steroid up there can certainly make things a lot worse. So how do we assess the strength of a steroid cream? And the answer to that is we assess it by assessing it. Well, we assess its strength by assessing the degree of vascular constriction. When a fixed amount of steroid cream is applied to a fixed area of skin surface, it's not just the degree; it's the length of time of the vasoconstriction as well. Because topical steroids applied to the skin will cause a blanching of the skin. You know, if you have put a topical steroid in your skin, you'll see that it will blanch it. And that's because it's having a vasoconstrictive effect on the underlying blood vessels. So the degree of vasoconstriction and the length of that vasoconstriction determines the strength of a topical steroid. A weak steroid, like 1% hydrocortisone, it won't cause terribly much in the way of vasoconstriction at all. It doesn't last for any length of time. Whereas a strong topical steroid, like diprazone, will cause quite a significant degree of vasoconstriction, and it'll be prolonged. Now, note these percentages business. Hydrocortisone 1%, you might think, oh, that's obviously a lot stronger than 0.02% betamethasone. But these are two different steroid molecules. You know, betamethasone is about 10 times stronger at vasoconstricting than 1% hydrocortisone. So 0.02% betamethasone is 10 times stronger than 1% hydrocortisone. And this vasoconstrictive effect is a surrogate marker for the anti-inflammatory effect of the topical steroids, because topical steroids are the best anti-inflammatory medications that we have. So don't get seduced by the percentage. It depends on the molecule, with betamethasone being about 10 times more vasoconstrictive, or the 0.02% betamethasone being about 10 times more vasoconstrictive than 1% hydrocortisone when the same amounts apply to the same surface area of skin. That's an important thing to remember. This is flexural psoriasis. It's moist, it's underneath the surface of the breast, you've got two layers of breast together here, and often you get little satellite things coming out here, little satellite lesions, and these are little satellite lesions, you can't see it with this image, these are little satellite lesions of candida. Whenever you've got a moist, weepy area anywhere, then you'll get a bit of candida superimposed on it, in the groin, under the breast, abdominal fat folds, and go looking for little satellite pustules. These are little pustules that are distinct from the outer edge of wherever the rash is, and that's a characteristic feature of candida. So what cream would you use to try and deal with this? Well, it's a flexural surface, two occluded wet surfaces together, so you're not going to put a strong fluorinated steroid in there. If you do that, you're just going to, well, you get too much absorption, you're going to thin that skin very quickly. So you're only going to use 1% hydrocortisone there, and you've got that candida to deal with as well. So you could add in a bit of canesten cream, which is an imidazole, an antifungal, or you could get a cream called hydrazole, which is a mixture, proprietary mixture of 1% hydrocortisone and clotrimazole. And it's a very useful preparation for flexural rashes. You don't need a strong fluorinated steroid there. A weak one's fine to be absorbed across that skin. And the clotrimazole will deal with a bit of secondary candida that's there. This condition is normally scaly on elbows and knees. What is it? I've told you. All right, it's psoriasis. Flexural psoriasis. Okay, yep. The combination of 1% hydrocortisone and antifungal clotrimazole is the best treatment. Now, let's go into these steroids a little bit more. Here we go. Hydrocortisone, 1% or 0.5% are the weakest steroids that we have. Now, you don't need a script for these. You can buy these at the chemist. I think they go under the name of Dermade. And there's both 1% and 0.5%. They're often used more in, you use them in children a bit. The other thing you've got to remember about children is they've got a relatively large surface area relative to their weight, so they can absorb topical steroids if they're applied all over the body to a significant amount. But it's rare that you're going to be applying a strong steroid to a kid all over. 1% hydrocortisone is usually used in areas such as around the eyes, on the face. Now, why do we mention that on the face? One of the big problems, remember that condition of perioral dermatitis, where a fluorinated steroid, if that was applied to the facial skin with the grease glands, it would induce the condition called, if you can remember, perioral rosacea, perioral dermatitis, where there's a wee bit of sparing around the lips and you've got this papulopustular rash, sometimes with a wee bit of scale in that circumoral area. Well, if you use a fluorinated steroid for any length of time, you'll induce that. You won't induce it with 1% hydrocortisone, or very rarely. I mean, I have seen it induced by 1% hydrocortisone, but not often. Now, after the 1% hydrocortisone comes the betamethasone preparations, and the weakest of these is the 0.02% betamethasone, and that goes under the name of Celestone M cream. Equivalents are Aristocort, which is 0.02% triamcinolone, and Kenalone, which again is a betamethasone. They're all the same, these molecules, the triamcinolone and the betamethasone are the same sort of potency as vasoconstrictors. You get big 100-gram tubes of them, Whereas if you got with the stronger fluorinated steroids, the stronger versions, you only get 15-gram tubes. So we have big 100-gram tubes of these because they're relatively weak and you use them for larger surface areas. I've said that this 0.02% betamethasone is 10 times stronger than 1% hydrocortisone. We've talked about this vasoconstrictive effect. Then you can have half-strength betamethasone, you know, 0.05% strength. And this is half-strength betnovate. Again, it's obviously stronger. It's more vasoconstrictive than 0.02% betamethasone. It comes in a smaller tube, though. So you'd use that for more difficult or thicker areas, say of psoriasis or lichen simplex chronicus, where the skin's thicker and it's not going to be an issue of thinning the skin. You need to apply your topical steroid for quite some time before you're going to thin the skin. You know, a month or more would be needed. Even in a flexural area, you'd need to apply it for a fair bit of time before that's going to happen. And then you've got full strength betnovate, 0.1% betnovate. This is a potent topical steroid, and it really can thin the skin if it's applied to flexures. And also, in areas of the arms and the face, it'll cause telangiectasia, you know, dilated, broken little blood vessels in the skin. And, of course, this rosacea business on the face. Now, there are other almost equally efficacious topical steroids available, and they're less likely to cause side effects, and these are mometasone or Elecon or Novasone in Australia, they're just the same, but mometasone and Advantan, which is methylprednisolone cream. So you just not, there's not many steroids you need to know. You need to know hydrocortisone, you need to know a bit of celestone, a bit of half-strength betnovate, and then Elecon and Advantan and a bit of Diprazone. Diprazone is 0.05% betamethasone dipropionate. And it's almost as strong as 0.1% betamethasone that's in betnovate. So Advantan is a useful preparation. It's got a much better safety profile than most of the other stronger steroids, but it's not quite as potent as mometasone or full-strength betnovate. But Advantan can be useful in children, say a kid with bad atopic dermatitis in the face, and you want to try and get that settled quickly. You might use the Advantan daily for 3 days, along with, say, a wee bit of Bactroban cream, which is a topical antibiotic cream to deal with a secondary staph infection. And then after that, switch over to 1% hydrocortisone with moisturizers, just to try and keep it settled after that. So it's quite safe to use that, even in young kids with a good going facial dermatitis. There's no real problem with Advantan used like that over 3-4 days at a time. Have a break, 3-4 days again if it flares. Yeah, we've said that, provided it's used for a short period of time, 1 to 2 weeks at the most. Now, the other thing about topical steroids, if you're prescribing them, is to make sure you give the patient enough to do the job. You know, if you're applying a steroid all over the body, say you're applying a cortisone cream, you're going to apply it face, back, chest, all the way down the legs and the arms. How much are you going to need? The answer to that is you're going to need about 30 grams of the stuff for one full body application. Now, I've said here already, some of the strong steroid creams, the tubes, they only come in 15-gram sizes. So, you know, if you had a 15-gram tube of Elecon, for instance, you'd need two of them to cover someone who's got dermatitis all over just with one application. And then I've said, though, you know, that sort of situation is rare. I mean, obviously, most people just have a localized dermatitis in specific body areas. How do you measure the body area that's involved? Well, the palm of the hand is roughly equivalent to about 1% of the total surface area of the body. So you can get a rough idea from that. How much cream should someone apply to the skin? I think we go on to that actually probably in the next bit. Let me leave that till the next section. I'll come back to that. But anyway, just to get back to this issue of about sizes, you know, how much cream to supply to someone. Get a rough idea of the area that's involved with the rash. Know that, you know, 30 grams is needed for, say, 100% of the body area for one application. So if you've got 10 hands worth of dermatitis, then that's going to be roughly 3 grams of cream you're going to need for just one application, 6 grams for two applications, you know, if it's going on twice daily. So a little 15-gram tube's only going to last about 2.5 days in those circumstances. So you can get in touch with the PBS here. You phone them, the authority numbers. Now, I think we come to that in a minute. And you can get increased amounts for patients. In other words, instead of the normal 15 grams on one repeat, you could, you know, you can get the, you can get 100 grams and two repeats. You can get really as much as you need. Theoretically, you can get a month's supply and two repeats of a month. The maximum I ever heard of anyone ever prescribing was a patient who got 90 N90 tubes of Elecon cream at one time. I don't know what the doctor was thinking about. I mean, the condition is going to come under control a lot more quickly than that. The what I normally do myself is it's 15 grams times six and two repeats, and I expect that patient to come under control with that amount of medication fairly quickly. I'm not needing to give the patient a lot more than that. I just didn't know how he managed to get away with getting that anyway. But there would be a wee clerk at the other end that would just quietly say, yes, that's fine, doctor, and give them the number and off he'd go. Now, let's look at this rash. This is on the lower legs. It looks like a dermatitis. There's some broken areas of skin here. What strength of topical steroid would you use for this? Well, would you put a bit of 1% hydrocortisone on that? Short answer is no. It ain't going to be enough. It's not going to be enough to settle that type of dermatitis that's there when it's as extensive as that, and then that lower leg as well. You're going to need at least some Celestone M cream for this, the 0.02% betamethasone. So you'd prescribe, you know, 200 grams, 100 grams on one repeat of Celestone M cream for that with twice daily application. If you think there's some secondary infection there, you'd either give an oral antibiotic or you'd give a little bit of Bactroban cream as well. What if we said, yeah, mid or high potency Celestone M or Mometasone, you might give the Elecon cream for that to deal with it. Okay, next little question. What's tachyphylaxis? It's a nice big name, isn't it? Tachyphylaxis. The problem of having to use more of a topical steroid as time goes on. Why? We think because the skin becomes used to it. I think what really happens is that enzymes are induced in the skin that actually break the stuff down, break the steroid molecule down. So you get this decreasing responsiveness of the skin to the drug because of this enzyme induction. And so for this reason, we'll tell patients to use topical steroids intermittently. In other words, you use it twice daily till you get the inflammation settled, which can occur very quickly, you know, 3-4 days at the most. And then we tell them to back off and either reduce the frequency to one a day for a few days and then stop, or just tell them to stop and just moisturize the skin and wait and see how long it takes for the inflammation to flare up again, and then go back to using the steroid for another 3 or 4 days topically to get it under control. Sometimes some people put a steroid cream on, it settles things down, and then they keep putting it on, almost as if they're putting on a moisturizer. And they look at it almost as a moisturizer. And that's just a recipe, one, for tachyphylaxis occurring, and two, for inducing some degree of steroid atrophy or some other problems from the topical steroid being applied. So intermittent use of topical steroids, 4 or 5 days at a time at the most, and then having a break and then using them again is a better way of doing it. And if you've got someone who's requiring chronic steroid, topical steroid use for the, you know, if they've got a chronic disease like lupus or bullous pemphigoid where you're getting away with topicals, what you can do is change from one steroid molecule such as betamethasone to another such as the mometasone, the Elecon. or even to the quinolone, the triamcinolone, and changing from one molecule to another steroid molecule sometimes helps as well. Now, does contact dermatitis occur to a topical steroid? You know, we usually use topical steroids to deal with contact dermatitis, be it plant contact dermatitis or dermatitis from hair dye or nickel contact dermatitis from jean studs or belts or watches. We usually use a steroid to deal with that. But you can develop a contact allergy to the topical steroid, and it can either be to the steroid molecule itself or to a preservative that's in a steroid cream, or occasionally to some perfume that might be in there as well. All creams, by the way, have to have preservatives in them, because otherwise, being a cream, they would go off. If they didn't, they get bacterial contamination, they go off. So all creams have preservatives. Ointments don't have preservatives, so they can be used in patients who are allergic to preservatives. But unfortunately, some patients can actually become allergic to the steroid molecule. Here's a patient who's had patch testing carried out. Now, this lot here is the European standard battery of allergens. That's a whole series of things, you know, nickel, rubber, potassium dichromate, glues, etc., etc., that are tested as that. Then there's, and there's another, so there's another little group there that's part of that. It's 24 in the European standard battery. And this little lot here were the steroid molecules and a couple of other preservatives. You can test for steroid molecule allergy. There are certain molecules that you get in the test series that will pick up if someone's allergic to a steroid molecule itself. This patient wasn't, that bit was quite clear, but she was allergic to other things here. I think that's nickel. If that's 19, then I think it's nickel. I think that's cobalt back here. Nickel and cobalt go together. I think that was formaldehyde. Either that or colophony. I can't remember which number that was. Colophony, by the way, is the allergen in elastoplast. And formaldehyde is a cheap preservative. It's in a lot of shampoos and sometimes in creams and the like as well. But anyway, that's the result of patch testing, where an allergen's been on the skin for 48 hours, and then we strip it off, and this is the end result. There's a wee bit of allergen that's in a little aluminium well that fits in over. There's 10 of these little aluminium wells in a patch here, and with different allergens in each one. And this is when you get a positive reaction. You get this sort of round little circle of itchy dermatitis that comes up. So steroid molecules are number 1 to 6 on the right-hand side of this patch testing. She was negative. Some positive reactions to other substances. What are the commonest allergens in creams? Well, we've said preservatives and perfumes are the commonest allergens. Let's just see if I agree with myself. Cheap preservatives and perfumes are the commonest allergens in creams. Okay. All right. Now we just talk a little bit more about the adverse reactions from applied steroids. We've already talked of this condition, perioral dermatitis. Look at that bit of sparing around the vermilion border, you know, a bit of sparing in here. That's quite a big, sometimes it's only maybe 2 to 3 millimeters of sparing round about, but it's curious how you get that. You can see there are some pustules there, little pustules, and it's also red and slightly scaly as well. And you know, don't let the scale put you off. You might look at that and think it's some sort of infected dermatitic process. That's why sometimes this is called perioral dermatitis. But if you actually look at the histology is more a rosacea histology with inflammation in the dermis itself. There's obviously a little bit of spongiosis to get that sort of epidermal scaling. You have to get some sort of pathology in the epidermis to give scaling like that as well. But it's not the primary pathology in this condition. So this will be induced by fluorinated steroids. You know, perhaps the patient maybe had a little bit of seborrheic dermatitis. We better scale up here first. And they'd put the topical steroid on to deal with that. Now, the doctor may not have prescribed it. It may have, in fact, been prescribed for someone else with a hand dermatitis or something, you know, and they've had it at home. And they then stick it on their face. And it works at first because it's very anti-inflammatory. It'll settle the seborrheic dermatitis down. But then it encourages overgrowth of Demodex, and then you gradually get the spread of that, and you get this perioral rosacea picture coming up. So any fluorinated steroid, and we particularly see the problem with Elecon, and we certainly see it with Diprazone, we'll see it with Celestone being applied to the face, Rarely will you get it with Advantan, and exceedingly rarely will you ever get it with 1% hydrocortisone. So watch for this, because as soon as the patient, you know, when the patient's using the steroid, all of this will settle down. When they stop using it, bang, that's when it will flare up after a few days. And of course, they keep putting it back on again. And so this vicious circle keeps going on, and this just expands further and further up the face. Now, the important thing is to give patients specific instructions. You know, I almost feel that these stronger fluorinated steroids should have something written on the box. You know, it should say, not for use on face for longer than 1 week unless instructed by your doctor. Because it's just such a common problem of misuse. The other areas where people get into trouble with topical steroids are going to be the groin. Again, these in the groin, you've got an occlusive surface, and if you put a strong fluorinated steroid down there, you're going to thin the skin, and I think we'll show you some examples of that in a minute. This bit was all about perioral dermatitis because it is an important... how do you treat this condition? Well, one, you've got to tell them, you know, in fact, I usually bring the creams in with them, and I usually take it off them and put it in the bucket. I give them a script for some tetracycline, either doxycycline, 50 milligrams twice daily, or minimycin, 50 milligrams twice daily. And I give them a cream, 2% sulfur in sorbolene. Just give them 100 grams of that. Just get 2% sulfur, stick it in some sorbolene cream. The sulfur has an effect on Demodex and will reduce it. You put that on twice daily. The minimycin you take twice daily with food. They've got to take it for at least 4 weeks, maybe even six, to get it to settle down properly. But the main thing is to take the topical steroid off them and make sure they realize not to use it again. Topical steroid withdrawal, oral tetracycline, said 1% there. I often use 2%. Smells a wee touch, 2% of sulfur, obviously, and it may take 4 to 6 weeks to settle. Yeah, this is the groin, and this is the problem with the groin. See these things here? These are striae, or stretch marks. You can almost see that sunken in there. It's a bit more inflamed up here, so almost as if there's a little bit of bruising and bleeding up there. And because you'll get some skin fragility, you may well get a wee bit of hemorrhage there. But these are the striae, or stretch marks, that have occurred here because of a strong topical steroid being used. I don't know what the rash was that was there. And it's even worse if there's topical steroids used and it's actually a tinea infection that's in there, and they've just used a strong steroid and they keep using it there to suppress the tinea infection. And what they end up with, still got the tinea infection, they just end up with these striae here. So only 1% hydrocortisone for the flexural areas. And remember, because often there's a bit of secondary candida, that hydrazole is very useful. This comes here in a 30-gram tube or a 50-gram tube in Australia. You can just buy it over the counter. You know, it's one of the best topical mixtures that you can, in fact, get for simple skin rashes that are inflammatory and in those areas. The other time where steroid atrophy is a big issue is in the elderly. You know, one of the problems we have here in Australia is all the sun damage that we have, and it thins the skin of the elderly. And then if you stick a strong fluorinated steroid on their skin, thins it even more. And invariably, they're all on warfarin or aspirin or something. You know, if they don't have hypertension, they've had a stroke or a TIA or something. And, you know, half the population that come in to see me are on blood thinners, which makes life difficult if I'm trying to cut skin cancers out of them. But similarly, they'll say, why am I bruising, doctor? And it's usually because they're on those, plus they've got solar atrophy of their skin, plus they may be sticking a steroid cream on their skin, when what they should be sticking on is a moisturizer and some sunscreen. That's what most of them need, not steroid creams. And if you do get that sort of steroid atrophy, the veins really stand out, telangiectasia appears, spontaneous hemorrhaging and bruising. So I've said, just in the elderly, just moisturize them. Don't use strong steroids for any length of time. Bring them back and make sure they go down to 1% hydrocortisone once you've used your strongest steroid for a week or two to get whatever rash is under control. These were just some other pictures of steroid atrophy, and I think these were just little retention cysts from overuse of steroids in the axillae. Yeah, there's a question for you. Striae can also occur in what other situations? Well, certainly if you've got endogenous excess cortisol, you know, by that I mean Cushing's syndrome, for instance, where you've got overproduction of cortisol from your adrenals, certainly you can, either as a primary or a secondary phenomenon, you can certainly get a lot of striae then, and they're usually on the abdomen, on the abdominal wall. Adolescents, males and females, they'll get striae, they'll get stretch marks as well, usually when they grow quickly. You know, women, get, the girls get it on the breasts and the thighs, the boys get it in the lower back. And the stretch marks are initially pink like this, and then they go pale. Pregnancy, obviously, you know, you get a lot of stretch marks and striae in pregnancy. So there are other conditions that can cause that. This is the other situation of side effects of strong topical steroids, and that's when you put it on the wrong thing. And this is a guy who has a tinea infection. I think I've shown you his picture earlier on. Look at the outline of this scaly rash here. Look at it, all the way here, all the way here. It's even extending right down here onto its arm, all the way around here. So, and it's all the way up here. So this was thought to be a dermatitis. I think he was given Celestone cream. He'd been applying it for a long time. And, of course, it was a dermatophyte fungus. And it was quietly growing across his back. The steroid would suppress any inflammatory reaction. And if the rash did seem to flare, he'd stick more steroid on it. But, of course, the little fungus just marched happily along here, right across his back. And that's sometimes known as tinea incognito, where a steroid's been used for some time suppressing the inflammatory reaction, sometimes suppressing the scale as well. Here's another example, probably a better example here on the on this this guy's arms. Let's just wait till that one comes up in your screen. It might be a bit more difficult to pick this one, but you know, you can see the edge there. There's normal skin. You can see the edge there. Can't see it quite there. It comes up here. You can see the bruising and the like here. See it better on this side. Look at the edge of this here. There's the edge of your fungus all the way around here. But then all of this is all fungal down here where he's been applying the steroids for some period of time. I missed a case like this recently. I wouldn't have missed that one, but I did miss one that came into the rooms recently, and I thought he had some sort of photosensitive eruption because it was the outer aspect of the arms like this, and he had been applying the topical steroids to it as well, and I was looking at his drugs and what have you, and at least I had enough sense to do a little punch biopsy because it looked a bit funny, and lo and behold, the pathologist, you know, quietly sent me back saying, yes, you know, there are, I'm seeing fungal hyphae and in the just in the stratum corneum. So all of this is a dermatophytosis. So needless to say, he came off his topical steroids that he had been applying for some time. We gave him some oral griseofulvin, and his wee arms will be cleaning up quite nicely. I did do some scrapings when he came back to get a stitch out from his punch biopsy, so we'll see what it is that we grow as well, which fungus it is. So, just remember, strong steroids can suppress fungal infections and they can grow, but you'll always get a good edge like that, and that's what should alert you. And you should still try and do some scrapings to be able to pick up the fungus, and generally you have to stop the steroid cream and put them on some griseofulvin orally to try and clear it. I've said there, what's the likeliest fungus in this guy's back? Well, the commonest one, if you pick up from another human being, or to is one you maybe transfer from your groin. It's going to be trichophyton rubrum. Oh yeah, tinea rubrum. I've said it should be trichophyton rubrum. That's the one that commonly affects the soles of your feet and the palms of your hands as well. And there's just, I think, the last of the little things. One of my colleagues, we talked about cataracts. We talked about glaucoma near the eye. You can also get cataracts from locally applied strong steroids near the eye, although it's usually oral steroids that are more likely to give you cataracts. But glaucoma, certainly, from strong fluorinated steroids near the eyes, so don't do that. And what have we got here? Yeah, this is the vasoconstriction again. We talked about that as well. If a steroid is applied to a region of an ulcer, a near an ulcer, then it can impair healing of an ulcer. So say you've got a varicose ulcer on the leg and you've got varicose dermatitis, then you can apply the steroid to your dermatitis, but leave about a centimeter around the ulcer itself. You know, don't put the steroid cream there, or it can interfere with the healing of the ulcer. Also, you can get hypopigmentation of the skin from topical steroids as well. And the other phenomenon you can get is excess hair growth. You know, if you've been applying a strong fluorinated steroid to, say, a patch of discoid eczema or lichen simplex chronicus in the lower legs, and the person happens to be hairy, then after a period of time, you may well, as well as getting the dermatitis settled, you may suddenly get thickened hair growing in that area. So you can get that phenomenon. Just watch out for it. And this was just must have been a nice picture of this. It's a rare condition. It's called trichostasis spinulosa. And what happens is you get a series of hairs all growing out of the one follicle. You know, instead of one little hair, you get a whole bunch of them growing out like this. And this was apparently induced by the use of a strong fluorinated steroid in one of Shabazz's patients. Case of trichostasis spinulosa occurring on the face due to a strong topical steroid called clobetasol. We don't have clobetasol here in Australia, but this is the strongest daddy of steroids that you can get. It's twice as strong as our diprazone, clobetasol, and we don't have it available in Australia. Sometimes you can get a formulating chemist to get the tablets in and bring it in and make it up for you. But it's very rarely that I ever have to use anything like that. Strongest steroid, by the way, that we have here is probably diprazone OV. And the OV stands from optimized vehicle. It's the base is such that you get more of the stuff into the skin than just with normal diprazone. And normally I find that's good enough for any of the really inflammatory lupus, lichen sclerosis or the like, where I might want to use a strong steroid. I would very rarely not find one of those adequate if I've got the right diagnosis. What's the defining feature of trichostasis spinulosa? Multiple little hairs coming out of the one follicle. So really, this was all about topical steroids. They're fundamental in dermatology because we have so many inflammatory skin diseases. So you need to know about them. You need to know where not to apply strong things and where to apply them. You need to know to apply them intermittently and then have a break. You need to know not to use fluorinated steroids in flexural areas or on the face. And you need to know to watch them with use around the eye. The stuff called Hycor eye ointment that you can get is just 1% hydrocortisone eye ointment. It's in a nice base so that if any goes in the eye, it doesn't irritate. So Hycor 1% eye ointment, HYCOR, is useful for any little periocular dermatitis or contact or the like there. So just know your steroid strengths. Hydrocortisone up to 0.02%, betamethasone, then to a bit of Advantan, then to mometasone, then to full strength betnivate, and diprazone and diprazone OV. That's the sort of going up weak to strong. Okay, any quick questions on that? Sorry, I know I've gone on a little bit about that, but anyone got any quick issues that they wanted to bring up about the stronger steroids? Nope. Okay. All right. We will leave that. And let's switch to the other thing I wanted to talk about today, which was some of the systemic drugs that we use in dermatology. Steroids were important. I did have another, I don't know if we'll have enough time to deal with it today, but I did do another one on just moisturizers and things like that. I'll put it up if we don't have time anyway. Sorry, let me just get to this. Systemic drug therapy in dermatology. Now, there are a variety of medicines that we may use in dermatology that are seldom used in other specialties. So you should be aware of them and what they are. And the first group I want to talk about are the retinoids. Retinoids are derived from vitamin A. You might think, oh, vitamin A, it's a nice natural substance. These must be natural things that are developed from it. Well, they're not natural. Acitretin or etretinate and isotretinoin are the two main retinoids. Isotretinoin you'll know better as Roaccutane, and it's, as you say, the major therapy for bad cystic acne. Etretinate or acitretin, you may know as neotigacin here in Australia. That's a retinoid that's used in psoriasis. Isotretinoin primarily works on grease glands. It shrinks the grease glands right down. That's why it's used in acne. And etretinate or neotigacin acts on the proliferating keratinocytes in the skin, and that's why it works on psoriasis and other psoriatic-like conditions, pityriasis, rubra-pilaris and the like, ones that have an overgrowth of keratinocytes in the skin. That's why it's useful there. Now, some of you might say, ah, overgrowth of keratinocytes. What about some skin cancers where there's overgrowth of keratinocytes? Is it tretinate or neotigacin any use there? And we do use it in patients who are immunosuppressed who have got a tendency to get squamous cell carcinoma. Then in those people, we sometimes put them on etretinate or neotigacin because it does slow down the rate at which they develop new SCCs. It's particularly useful in stopping them getting SCCs. So some immunosuppressed patients you might find are on an oral retinoid like that to try and stop them getting some skin cancers. But essentially, it's etretinate's the treatment of psoriasis, isotretinoin is the treatment of bad cystic acne. The big side effect of both of these drugs is that they are teratogenic, you know. That means if they're taken by a pregnant female in the first trimester of pregnancy, then, you know, with isotretinoin, 50% of the fetuses can be born deformed. So, you know, you just do not want these women to be exposed to these drugs. The good thing about isotretinoin is if they're on taking pregnancy precautions or they're on the pill, that drug is excreted from the system within about 10 to 12 days of finishing it, isotretinoin for acne. So they just stay on the pill for a month after finishing it and they're fine. Etretinate or neotigacin, unfortunately, that can hang around for 12 months. Acitretin is supposed to only last for about a month, but there have been small molecules of etretinate still found, and really I wouldn't use acitretin in any female of pregnancy, of potential pregnancy age. So you just don't use it in women who could fall pregnant, etretinate, even with contraception, because if they stop the contraception, the drug may still be hanging around for about 12 months afterwards. So we're very reluctant to use those drugs in women with psoriasis. We will use them in men, obviously, but not in women. So the major things as a medical student you should know about these retinoids, they are teratogenic. They interact badly with alcohol to give liver problems. So, you know, you've got to tell them if they're the young guys. Big problem I have just now. I'm going to schoolies, the young guy with his acne says. I won't get my acne better, but I'm going to schoolies. I'm going to be drinking for about a week. Can I stop the medicine before I go to schoolies? You know, sometimes I say to them, all right, son, you can do that. You've got to be off it for about 2 weeks beforehand. You know, if your acne gets bad when you're out there with those lovely young ladies, well, that's your problem. So some of them are sensible enough and lay off the grog and stay on their isotretinoin. Others take the other option. What else? You don't give tetracyclines with either of them. You know, if a patient's on isotretinoin or an etretinate, you don't give them some tetracyclines for anything else, you know, because the combination can give you this phenomenon of benign intracranial hypertension. What that means is, you know, the fluid ventricles in your brain, the pressure builds up in the fluid there, and you get this dull, remittent headache. It just stays there, unremittent headache, I should say, just stays there all the time, and gradually gets worse and worse. So you don't combine tetracyclines with retinoids. You can use other antibiotics, you know, Keflex, penicillin, erythromycin, there's no hassles. But if you use tetracyclines for any length of time with those, you can get benign intracranial hypertension. And you don't take extra vitamin A because they're synthesized from vitamin A. If you give them extra vitamin A, it just makes the dryness worse, the side effects worse. Okay. If you combine tetracyclines with a retinoid, what might happen? Well, you get benign intracranial hypertension. There was a guy with really severe generalized psoriasis. Look at it. I mean, he's erythrodermic from his psoriasis. We would want to try and get that shut off. Neotigacin takes a wee while to work with this, you know, 2 to 3 weeks or longer. And sometimes we'll combine the retinoid, the etretinate, with ultraviolet light. that combination can actually work quite well. But often if a patient's this erythrodermic from psoriasis, we give them another drug that we're going to talk about next, I think, called methotrexate. Okay, now, methotrexate and azathioprine. These drugs act on rapidly dividing cells. Now, you know, in psoriasis, the skin's growing 8 to 10 times faster than normal. So methotrexate will certainly work very well on rapidly dividing cells. Azathioprine can too, but it's not used in psoriasis as much as methotrexate is. Azathioprine is actually used in two major circumstances in dermatology. The first is in this condition of bullous pemphigoid. You know, the autoimmune bullous disease in the elderly, where they produce antibodies that attack attachment proteins that are attaching the epidermis to the dermis. And of course, that separates then, and then you get these thick-walled blisters on a red base. It's itchy red base first, and then thick-walled blisters. Well, normally you need oral steroids to suppress the immune reaction that's occurring that's producing these antibodies. But because steroids are such a problem, if patients are on them for any length of time, you've got to use a steroid-sparing agent, and that's where azathioprine comes in. It's a good steroid-sparing agent. It takes about 3 weeks to start working, azathioprine. And you have to check this little enzyme here, this thiopurine methyl transferase, TPMT enzyme. If someone is very low in that enzyme, then you've got to watch it. If you try giving them too high a dose of azathioprine, you'll affect their blood and you'll affect their kidneys. If they've got normal levels of this, then you can quietly increase, you know, you can go to your 50 and 100 milligrams, sometimes 150 milligrams of azathioprine, and it'll work well. But note if they've got this, if they've got a deficiency of this enzyme, you do not use high doses of azathioprine. You'll get, you'll run into trouble. And you've got to watch the blood count, you've got some kidney function, liver function. With methotrexate, the big thing you've got to watch is liver disease. So say you've got your pustular psoriasis patient or your bad psoriasis like that last one, you're going to give them methotrexate. You give them methotrexate as a weekly dose, just once a week is all you need. And it's somewhere between 10 and 15 milligrams as a single dose can be used. In rheumatoid arthritis, it's often used as well, but they'll often use 20, 25 milligrams in rheumatoid arthritis. We tend to only use 10 to 15 milligrams with psoriasis. Prolonged use can rarely give rise to liver fibrosis, but it takes a long time before you're going to get a cirrhotic liver from taking methotrexate. Why? Because you need to have at least 2 grams of the drug as an accumulated dose. Now, if you're taking, say, 10 milligrams a week, that's 500 milligrams a year. Well, 4 years you'd need to take stuff before you get anywhere near the 2 grams. And sometimes liver biopsies are then recommended at that stage to make sure that you haven't got any liver fibrosis occurring, because often your blood tests aren't that accurate in deciding. The rheumatologists don't seem to worry about it. They don't seem to see liver fibrosis in their patients, even though they use higher doses of it. So I can't really explain that. So methotrexate for pustular psoriasis and severe generalized plaque psoriasis, azathioprine for bullous pemphigoid, and it's also used in atopic eczema, severe generalized atopic eczema, both in children and in adults. This drug, and I mean though really chronic severe generalized, that isn't coming under control with all your basic therapies for atopic dermatitis, then azathioprine is a drug that can be considered 50 to 100 milligrams daily in an adult. And the pediatric boys use it in kids with severe atopic eczema as well. And they handle it fine. Is it important to give methotrexate in divided weekly doses? We used to do that. We used to give, you know, say I had someone on 15 milligrams, I'd give them 5 milligrams on a Tuesday night, 5 on a Wednesday morning, 5 on a Wednesday night. It used to be said that because of cell cycling times in psoriasis, that was the best way to give it, but I don't think that's quite true, in fact, although I still actually do it because I've done this for so long. But you can just give it as a single weekly dose. But remember, it's once a week. You've got to make sure you write that on the... Patients aren't used to taking medicines once a week. You know, they're used to taking something every day. So you want to make sure they understand, and it's written on the script, that it's once a week they're taking it. Here's another drug that's, really just found by dermatologists, or used by dermatologists, and that's this drug, Dapsone. It's a diamine diphenyl sulfone, Dapsone. It's a sulfonylurea. Now, Dapsone, the only other condition that dapsone is used is in leprosy. So leprosy or this condition, dermatitis herpetiformis. DH, or dermatitis herpetiformis, is seen in patients who have celiac disease, you know, gluten hypersensitivity. They may have flattening of their gut lining in celiac disease. But if they're going to get this blistering condition, this is where they're going to get it. They're going to get it on the elbows, the knees, over the scapulae and over the buttocks. And it's awfully itching. It's itchy as blazes. Small, little, intact blisters. Not much of a red base with these. And dapsone is a drug that can shut this process off within 48 hours. You give them dapsone and the itch is gone within 48 hours. The only thing you've got to check beforehand is, you know how we're talking with azathioprine, you did that enzyme test beforehand. Well, if you're going to use dapsone, there's another enzyme you've got to check for, and it's called glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase, G6-DPH levels. Some people don't have that normal level of enzyme, particularly people from the Mediterranean area, Greeks and the like. And if you give them dapsone, even a small dose, it can have a nasty effect. They'll get a hemolytic anemia. They'll knock off their red blood cells. They'll just lyse, and they'll get acutely anemic. So you've got to check the G6-DPH level. If it's normal, fine. Then you can start them off on 50 milligrams of dapsone. And I swear within 48 hours, all this itch will have settled and the inflammation will go and any blistering will go as well. It's that quick. And the only thing you've got to watch for is this hemolysis. You can get a low-grade hemolysis even if you've got a normal G6-DPH. So you've got to check the blood now and again. And the best test, by the way, this little thing here, what's the best test, blood test you can do as an indicator of hemolysis? The answer to that is the retic count. You just ask for them for the reticulocyte count. Rarely they can get a syndrome called the dapsone hypersensitivity syndrome if they've been on it for a wee while. And they get lymphadenopathy, fever, and joint swellings. And they can get methemoglobinemia as well. They go slightly purple. Methemoglobin doesn't carry oxygen as well. But these are rare things to occur. But dapsone, patients need to stay on it. Almost forever, unless they are awfully, awfully good and they go on a complete gluten-free diet. If they can stick a complete gluten-free diet, then this rash will go as well. But it takes a while for it to go, you know, even if they do that. And dapsone will certainly get it to go very quickly. So dapsone, either it's used in leprosy or it's one of the three drugs that are used in the triple therapy of leprosy. And it's also used in dermatitis herpetiformis. What were the other things? Yeah, some of the antifungal drugs, the oral ones, you know, we use them in dermatology, don't you use them much anywhere else? The main ones you have to know about are griseofulvin and some of the azole drugs, either ketoconazole, which is used with yeast infections, or fluconazole, which some women take for candida, or itraconazole, which is used for the deep fungal infections, the sporotrichosis and the like, or there's terbinafine. Terbinafine is Lamisil. That's the one that's really good for fungal infection of nails. It's also good for fungal infections of the skin as well, but it used to be a lot more expensive. Griseofulvin was the only one that was available in the PBS for skin fungal infections. It still is. Terbinafine is only for nail fungal infections, but it's very good for skin too. And the main thing, terbinafine or Lamisil is fungicidal. It actually kills the fungus, whereas griseofulvin is fungistatic. Fungus won't grow in skin that has griseofulvin in it. If you take griseofulvin, it gets into the skin via the bloodstream, and it also gets in via the sweat. It's excreting the sweat, so it gets into the skin surface just from sweating on the surface. But it's fungistatic. It stops the fungus growing, and then as the body expels, you know how your skin's continually regenerating itself? Well, as the skin layers come to the surface and fall off, the fungus falls off with it. And provided you've been on your griseofulvin, it won't, you know, you'll have killed it, you'll get rid of it. But you've got to stay on it. Now, it's very effective for dermatophytes, you know, for your tinea infections, but it won't work for your candidas, griseofulvin. It doesn't work for candida. So So no point in giving it for yeast infections like Candida. Or, remember, Pityriasis versicolor, that little yeast infection on the back that gives you the white areas with the tanned skin round about, it won't work on that either because it's a yeast. What do you have to use for that? You've got to use ketoconazole. It's one of the azoles, the oral azoles. And ketoconazole, Nizoral, 200 milligrams daily will work nicely for yeast infections. With Griseofulvin, by the way, you've got to take it with a fatty meal or ice cream. And I've said that it's fungistatic. So most skin infections need 4 to 6 weeks of therapy. It's not like an antibiotic you take with a week. Remember, the skin in some areas of the body, like the palms of the hand, takes about 2 months to grow from the base of the epidermis to the surface. So if you've got a fungal infection there, you've got to have Griseofulvin in that skin for 2 months to make sure that you get rid of it all because it's fungistatic. The other little thing about Nizoral, by the way, for yeast infections, it interacts with many drugs through a thing called the cytochrome P450 system. This is a system in the liver that's involved in the metabolism of a variety of drugs. And ketoconazole is a competitive inhibitor of this. So it will inhibit that system such that drugs that require that to break them down, those drugs will be circulating in higher levels. So some anticoagulants and other drugs will have be much more effective more effective than you might want if that you give the patient Nizoral as well. So you've just got to watch interactions if you're going to prescribe Nizoral for a yeast infection or candida somewhere. Short-term use in the elderly is no great issue. It also, Nizoral, by the way, also has about 1 in 2,000 risk of developing patient getting severe hepatitis. So say you stick him on it for some fungal infection somewhere for 2 months, a dermatophyte infection, then you run that risk. And I don't usually use it for dermatophytes, only used for yeast infections that for relatively short periods of time. And we use terbinafine for nail and fungal infections and Griseofulvin for some of the skin fungal infections. Would you use Nizoral to treat a fungal nail infection? No, because they'd have to be on it for a long period of time. You might get that hepatitis business. Antibiotics, yeah, we use a fair bit of antibiotics. Use a lot of tetracyclines in acne. You used to have them on it for 2 years or more at a time. Nowadays, we only have them on tetracyclines. I put them on, let's say, doxycycline or minimycin. I bring them back at 3 months. I see how they are. If they've done well with it, I keep them on it for another 3 months. Then I stop it. And then I wait and see what happens. If they flare again, then I'll put them on raw Accutane, on that retinoid isotretinoin. We use a lot of, because we get a lot of staph infection, like this nice crusts of impetigo, we use a lot of Flu-Clox and Diclox. Flu-Clox can give a hepatitis, so nowadays they recommend oral Diclox. You don't have a syrup form of Diclox, though, so for some kids, you've got to give them some Flu-Clox as the oral. Usually they don't have to be on it for any length of time. But we do use those dicloxacillin, flucloxacillin, the penicillinase-resistant penicillins quite a lot. The other little drug that you might come across is a drug called pimazine. It's more difficult to get now. Pimazine is used in patients who have delusions of parasitosis. God forbid if you get any patient that comes in like that, because they'll usually bring in a wee container that has various skin scales and bits of thread and things that have been picked up off the floor. And they'll say to you, these are the crawling insects that are, infesting my skin or coming out of my skin. And you look at them with your dermatoscope or under your microscope. And it doesn't matter even if you show the patient that, look, there's nothing there. They've got this fixed delusion that there is. And it's a true psychosis. And unfortunately, they need a drug that's like that. Or that if you can't get that one, nowadays the other one we use is risperidone. I'm not very good at prescribing these, so I'm afraid that because I don't use it much, I usually get them to try and see their own doctor, and I get their doctor to prescribe that for them. Or if the doctor's not happy, they'll try and get them to a psychiatrist, but these patients are awfully resistant to go anywhere near a psychiatrist. They don't believe that there's, they have a psychiatric problem at all. But patients who suffer from delusions of parasitosis are an awfully difficult group to try and treat. There was a weak question there. What's the cross-reactivity between penicillin and cephalosporin? About 5% of patients with penicillin allergy will also be allergic to a cephalosporin. So you've just got to watch that if you're thinking of using a cephalosporin because the patient's penicillin allergic. Nearly finished. The last of the systemic drugs I wanted to talk about, cyclosporin. We're not doing it so much now in dermatology, but cyclosporin has an effect on T cells in the skin, so it's useful for a variety of immune disorders that are T cell related. But it used to be used a lot in psoriasis. It was used a lot in atopic dermatitis as well. The big problem with cyclosporin is it causes hypertension and renal disease, and so you've got to monitor it carefully, monitor the blood pressure, monitor the kidney function, and also it can really cause a lymphoma. And here in Australia, the other problem we had was that it increased the rate at which patients developed skin cancers. To some extent, that's also the same with patients who are on azathioprine and who are on methotrexate. They're at more risk of developing a variety of skin cancers as well. So you sometimes find when you give them those drugs, the rate of SCC development in someone who's had a lot of sun exposure will suddenly increase. So it's an issue with any of these sort of immune suppressant type drugs. I've said there that it, you know, with patients on cyclosporin, there was at least a six-fold increase in incidence of skin malignancies when they were on it, mainly SCC rather than melanoma. And the last little group of drugs that we did speak about when we were doing psoriasis were these biologics. Now, you're going to come across them in a variety of fields of medicine because the biologics are monoclonal antibodies. Some of them are pure human molecules. Others are mixtures of a mouse and a human molecule. And they're directed towards a cytokine called tumor necrosis factor alpha, TNF-alpha. It's one of the most common inflammatory cytokines that are involved in all sorts of inflammation. So it's involved in Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, rheumatoid arthritis, and it's also involved in psoriasis. So these cytokines are a big issue there, and they may also be involved in atopic dermatitis as well. And though we don't have good biologics for that yet, we do have good biologics. The TNF-alpha inhibitors are very useful in psoriasis, and these are dramatically effective drugs. But they're fiendishly expensive as well. So patients have to fail retinoids. They have to fail cyclosporin. They have to fail ultraviolet therapy or fail methotrexate. They've got to fail three out of those four before they are able to even get a biologic on our PBS system. And the biologics can be given by injection every couple of weeks, or there's one called infliximab that can be given as an infusion every 3 months. And there are some new, there are new biologics coming out all the time. The drug companies have great largesse when they're trying to get you to prescribe these drugs. You know, they'll fly you down to meetings anywhere you want to go, and I rail against that, but some of my colleagues are quite happy to take them up on their offer. And give you a weekend in Melbourne or Sydney and hotel expenses and everything else. Why? Because it costs about $2,000 every 2 weeks for an injection of one of these drugs. That's why the government are very reluctant to have it prescribed unless patients fail all these other therapies. But there are a lot of new biologics coming out. There are other inflammatory cytokines that are involved that they're directing as well. So these drugs are going to be very important to us in the future. The main side effect from them, you've got to watch, they increase your risk of serious infection because they're shutting off part of your inflammatory reaction. So you've got to watch the risk of lymphoma, you've got to watch the risk of skin cancer as well, and you've got to watch TB and any other partially suppressed infective disorder that you might have. Bang, it can flare up when you're on those drugs. But they really are revolutionary. They can the lame will walk if they've got rheumatoid arthritis. The generalized psoriasis patient will be completely cleared. But of course, it's like everything. It works for a period of time, and then, especially the ones that are mixed molecules, you know, a bit of mouse molecule and a bit of a human molecule, you'll develop antibodies to the mouse component over time. But even the all human molecules, after a period of 2 to 3 years, the drug doesn't work as well and you need to switch to another biologic. But these are going to be the drugs of the future as anti-inflammatories. And they're much less serious than, say, using steroids as an anti-inflammatory. So I think you do need to know about the biologics, the TNF-alpha inhibitor drugs. So this was just another red scaling disease. This is pityriasis rubra pilaris. They have these islands of scaling. It looks like psoriasis, but they get an ectropion. They get very thick pans and soles, and it's a self-limiting disorder. Over a period of about 9 to 12 months, it will disappear. All right, we're nearly finished. Antihistamines, we use these a lot in dermatology. You'll use them in hay fever, other allergic disorders, ones that are IgE-mediated, that are releasing histamine from mast cells, then antihistamines work. But remember, they're only going to work provided you've got a decent dose on board. You have to be taking them for it to work. If you wait till the Hy-Vee rash comes out and then take your antihistamines, it's not going to do much. There are H1 and H2. In fact, I think there's up to H4 receptors now. But our old conventional antihistamines that made you sleepy, they were mainly H1 blockers. You know, Phenergan, Periactin, those types, cyproheptadine, those types of medications. Then along came the H2, the longer-lasting type of antihistamine. And these were ones like Zyrtec and Telfast and Claritin. These were long-acting antihistamines. They're still psoriatic type 1. The type 2 antihistamines are the ones that lie inside of the gut. You know, the cimetidine was a type 2 histamine blocker. But it didn't really have much effect on the IgE-mediated histamine release from mast cells. These long-acting antihistamines, by the way, the Zyrtec, Telfast, Claritin, the dose is supposed to be one a day, but I can tell you from experience, you often need two a day, one in the morning, one at night. They're really not, if you just use one a day, it's not going to be enough to act as an efficient antihistamine the whole day. So you usually need two a day of these medications. Or combining a non-sedating one in the morning, like Zyrtec, with a sedating one at night can be very useful as well. Just watch with alcohol. Make sure you always remember to tell a patient that, look, your antihistamine might react with alcohol, and watch if you're trying to drive a motor vehicle. So that's the whole issue with some of the drugs that we use in dermatology. The majority of them, you can usually use them quite safely. You know, the methotrexate and Dapsone, so long as you know a little bit about it, so long with methotrexate, you're checking the liver function, checking the bloods regularly. With the azathioprine, you're checking bloods and you've checked the TMPT enzyme levels beforehand. The Dapsone, so long as you check the G6DPH and do a little blood count now and again. You can use these medicines relatively safely. You don't need any great expertise. You just need to be aware of the problems that can occur with them. And the other big thing with all of these drugs is the interaction with other medications that patients are taking. I mean, one of the big problems in medicine we have with elderly patients is that they are on multiple drugs. And you know, if you're on more than about three drugs and you add in another one, the risk of a significant drug interaction occurring is about 30%. Some of these old ducks are on anything between 9 and 12 different medications a day. And it's little wonder that we see all the sort of drug reactions, or patients don't feel particularly well at times. I honestly don't think anyone should be on more than three drugs at any one time. And if you are going to add in something else, you've got to say, well, which one am I going to knock off? And I think if we did that, we'd have many more healthy elderly people and certainly poorer pharmaceutical companies. But we're not here to benefit the pharmaceutical companies. Mind you, they do a lot of good work in developing a lot of these drugs anyway. Okay, that was as much as I wanted to talk about with these systemic drugs. I know that, you know, you may not use them, but they are important in a lot of fields of dermatology, and you should be aware of them. You're going to use the antifungals. You may use methotrexate at some stage. We've talked of oral steroids in other circumstances. The retinoids are restricted to dermatologists and to physicians because of that teratogenicity, but that situation may change in the future, so you need to know about the retinoids as well and that you don't mix tetracycline with them. But those are the main things that you need to know about with these drugs. Any questions, any thoughts, any issues that you've perhaps come across with any of these? Rao, let me come to you. Yeah, Rao. Hi.
I want to know what is the role of topical gentamicin
Topical
in the treatment.
gentamicin.
Yes.
I very rarely would use topical gentamicin at all. In fact, we rarely use gentamicin. I mean, one of the big problems with gentamicin was when it was given intravenously was that it caused ototoxicity. That was one of the big issues with it, and you had to monitor your gentamicin levels, and it was mainly used for severe gram-negative infections. Topical gentamicin, I don't think we have it in terms of any topical antibiotic here. We used to have topical neomycin, but I even because it caused a lot of allergies as well, I don't think we even have it anymore. Where do you practice? Are you overseas?
Yes, I'm in India.
Okay, so you're able to get topical gentamicin there, are you?
I've seen some people have prescribed like for in mixed infection with steroids,
Okay,
but I've not.
sure. I mean, we still have we have Otocom here, which is triamcinolone, and I think it has sofromycin, an antibiotic in it as well as an antifungal. So you do get these combination type medicines, but I've never been a great believer of them. I suppose the only one I keep mentioning is hydrazole, the mixture of clotrimazole and hydrocortisone. But I don't think we can get topical gentamicin here in Australia, and I'm sure there's any of these micin antibiotics. I think there's always an issue of contact allergy developing. So, unfortunately, I can't give you any real experience of them. Do you find it's quite useful in the preparations that you have in India that you use? Do you find them quite useful?
It has to be useful. They have not used it for a long time, though,
Sure, sure.
for long periods.
Sure. No, you wouldn't want to. They may develop sensitivities and the like to it. Okay, interesting. I mean, it's interesting the variations, in different countries as to what we use and what's available in different countries anyway. Thanks for that. Any questions? Amal, let me come to you. Yeah, Amal.
Hello.
Hello.
How do you treat? Please, how do you treat perioral dermatitis? And what is the role of antifungal in treating it? Do you
No,
have to use antifungal
no,
routinely?
no. See, remember, perioral dermatitis is usually caused by someone using a fluorinated steroid in the face. Not always. There'll be some women that will come in, and it seems to be something to do with cosmetics that they may be wearing. But the majority will have been using a fluorinated steroid. So you stop the fluorinated steroid. You tell them it's going to flare, but they've just got to put up with that for a week. You give them an oral tetracycline. Either doxycycline 50 milligrams twice daily or minimycin 50 milligrams twice daily, and they've got to stay on that for at least a month, and you give them some 2% sulfur and sorbolene, because remember it's overgrowth of a little organism called Demodex. It's a little mite, it's not a fungus. So you use the sulfur will penetrate there and will reduce the Demodex as well. So they put a wee bit of 2% sulfur and sorbolene cream on twice daily, and they use the therapy for at least a month. It will need a month. Usually your minimycin comes as a packet of 60, so if it's one twice daily, you've got 30 days of therapy there. So withdraw the topical steroid, use minimycin 50 milligrams twice daily and some 2% sulfur and sorbolene twice daily. Do that and it will all settle down nicely, but they'll flare that first week when you stop the steroid, the topical steroid. You've got to warn them of that, or else they'll think that it's the new cream they're putting on or the tablet they're taking or something like that. But if you do that, they'll get better. They all get better, I promise you.
Thank
Okay,
you.
no worries. Any other? Let me just flick up and down. Nope. Okay, look, thanks, folks. I hope you've enjoyed the series of lectures. They're up there in Student Skin Consult and in Skin Consult, so you'll be able to look at them there for some time and go back to them. And as I say, I've certainly enjoyed delivering the lectures to you. It's been something I've meant to do for some time. I've had the teaching cases there, but it's been good to actually deliver them as a lecture and have that available. I think perhaps you get a bit more out of listening and things getting pointed out on the screen than just sort of looking at it. So I hope you've enjoyed it. It's been a pleasure being able to chat to you. and perhaps we'll be able to do something like this again in the future anyway. Thanks again. Bye-bye.